that I want that you can put up. It's 1:10.
Yes, Guru Maharaj.
Okay. First canto, first chapter, 10th verse.
Yes, Guru Maharaj, I got it.
Om Gyanti Medandasya Ganajana Salakaya Chaksu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam. Nama Om Vishnu Badaya Krishna Pristaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Tinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pachari Ne Nevrasesa Sunyavari Vastyadya Deusatarine Panchakalpa Tarubhischa Kripa Sindhupa Evacha Patitanam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnave Bhyo Namo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna, Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhar, Sri Vasudhi Gaur, Bhaktivindam, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So today's topic is health, and I'm going to try to expand the gamut of health between spiritual health and the health that we defined as health, the physical body and the subtle mind. So we're going to go a little bit wide on this particular topic. And this verse, I think, is very, interesting, as it helps to give us a springboard from both types of health. This is spoken by Sutta Goswami. Prayenalpayesu sabdya kalavyasmin yuge janaha mandasumanda matayo manya bhagya upajutaha. That's actually, this is Sukadeva Goswami speaking to Maharaj Pariksit. O learned one, in this iron age of Kali, men almost always have but short lives. They are quarrelsome, lazy, misguided, unlucky, and above all, always disturbed. So you see from this translation, short lives are given, and some of the reasons why short lives are given. Purport: the devotees of the Lord are always anxious for spiritual improvement of the general public. When the sages of Namisharayan analyzed the state of affairs of people in the sage of Kali, they foresaw that men would live short lives. In Kali Yuga, the duration of life is short, not so much because of insufficient food, but because of irregular habits. This is important to note. Not because of insufficient food, because of irregular habits. By keeping regular habits and eating simple food, any man can maintain his health. Overeating, over sense gratification, over dependence on another's mercy, and artificial standards of living sap the vital energy of human, sap the very vitality of human energy. Therefore, the duration of life is shortened. People this of age are also very lazy, not only materially, but in the matter of self-realization. The human life is especially meant for self-realization. That is to say, man should come to know what he is, what the world is, and what the supreme truth is. Human life is a means by which the living entity can end all the miseries of hard struggle for life and material existence, by which he can return home back to Godhead, his eternal home. But due to a bad system of education, men have no desire for self-realization. Even if they come to know about it, they unfortunately become victims of misguided teachers. In this age, men are victims not only of different political creeds and parties, but also many different types of sense gratificatory devotions, such as cinemas, sports, gambling, clubs, mundane libraries, bad associations, smoking, drinking, cheating, pilfering, bickering, and so on. Their minds are always disturbed and full of anxieties due to many different engagements. In this age, many unscrupulous men manufacture their own religious faiths, which are not based on any revealed scriptures. I lost it now. And very often who are addicted to sense gratification and are attracted by such institutions. Consequently, in the name of religion, so many sinful acts are being carried out on that the people in general have neither peace of mind nor health of body. The students, brahmachari communities are no longer being maintained. The householders do not observe the rules and regulations of grihastha ashram. Consequently, the so-called vanaprasas and sannyasis who come out of such grihastha ashrams are easily deviated from the rigid path. In the Kali Yuga, the whole atmosphere is surcharged with faithlessness. Men are no longer interested in spiritual values. Material sense gratification is now the standard of civilization. For the maintenance of such material civilization, man has formed complex nations and communities, and there is a constant strain of hot and cold wars between different groups. It has become very difficult, therefore, to raise the spiritual standard due to the present distorted values of human society. The sages of Namisaranya are anxious to disentangle all fallen souls, and here they are seeking the remedy from Srila Sukta Goswami. So Srila Prabhupada Kija. So go back to the beginning of the purport. Yeah, perfect. So in each of the ages, there is a so-called calculated number of years that the people generally live. And there are four ages, as is described in the scriptures. There's the golden age, the silver age, the Bronze Age, and then the Iron Age. They're also equated with different types of metals. The Golden Age is Satya Yuga. The Silver Age is Treta Yuga. Bronze Age is Dwapara Yuga. And Iron Age is the present Kali Yuga. So we also see how it's concomitant with the different manufactured items. Nowadays, everything is made out of plastic or iron. Iron is very easy to come by. In fact, people just throw it in big piles when they don't have any use for it. And gold is very rare and hard to come by, and also considered to be a valuable metal. So this is the Iron Age. And here Prabhupada says duration of life is insufficient because of irregular habits, not because of insufficient food. So again, we see the different numbers of ages. In the Satya Yuga, people lived up to 100,000 years. You might say, how can a material body live that long? It's possible when the atmosphere and the activities are in line with the direction of the Supreme Lord. As time goes on, the ages start to develop certain inebrities. And as the inebrities continue, in the Satya Yuga, people followed all four principles: truthfulness, cleanliness, cleanliness, austerity, and and mercifulness. These are the four principles of religion: mercifulness, truthfulness, cleanliness, austerity. These are the four principles that religious principles sit upon. The four regulative principles by which we follow: no illicit sex, no intoxication, no meeting, no gambling. Each one of them aligns with one of these four. So as the ages continue to degrade, another religious principle is lost, and another one of these principles that starts, these inebrieties become prominent. So in Satya Yuga, all four were there. In Treta Yuga, I think what was lost a little bit was cleanliness, and then next stage, austerity was lost. And then in this age, only truthfulness is somehow hanging on by a thread, and that's destroyed by gambling or speculative lifestyles. As Prabhupada says here, he gives a whole list of certain things that people do which simply divert one's attention away and are unnecessary and sinful. So this is a very bad age, and therefore one of the most important prominent things in this age that people are struggling with, along with trying to maintain their life in any way, is health. When you speak about health, we speak about the maintenance and the upkeep of the body. And of course, it includes the psychological aspect of the living entity's well-being, his mind. People have no peace, and people's health in this age is always being challenged. Now, we hear that the material world has four built-in deficiencies: birth, death, disease, and old age. So disease is part of the material world. But we see in this age, people don't know how to maintain their health. And even if they do, they can't maintain it for any extended period of time. And so there is a struggle. Now, how does spiritual life connect with material health? Is there an overlap? Is there a connection? And the answer is yes. Not only yes, but it is a big yes. And that is, we see that the original principle of health is coming from the Vedas. And there is a place, there's a thing in Veda called Ayurveda. Ayurveda. Ayur means long-term or long-term maintenance. And Ayurveda is the science of well-being for the body, mind, and the soul in this age. And it's based on scripture. Ayurveda became prominent in this world in a particular pastime that's mentioned in the eighth canto of Srimad-Bhagavatam, where the demons and the demigods made a truce based on the idea that they would work together to get the elixir of immortality. And that elixir of immortality is known today as Ayurveda. So they, in the process of churning the milk ocean, of course, there's 10 chapters set aside in the Srimad Bhagavatam in the eighth canto describing these activities. But at one point, after successfully churning the ocean of milk, Danvantari comes out of the ocean, and in his hand, he has a pot of nectar. This nectar is the elixir of immortality, which the demons and the demigods worked together to get. When the demons saw Danvantari coming up with this, they attacked him and stole that pot of immortality, which was the elixir, which is the science of Ayurveda. But it came in the form of a liquid. in this particular pastime. Now, the science of Ayurveda is the science given by the Supreme Lord as the well-being of one's upkeep. As Srila Prabhupada mentions, the Vedas contain all subject matters, and one is health. And that health centers around a particular lifestyle that is connected with what we call Ayurveda. Ayurveda is very exact in how it works in terms of the original Ayurveda. Of course, there were actually 10 sections to the original Ayurveda. What is being followed today in today's Ayurvedic circles is about one of them. So most of it is lost. Of course, it's not lost in material. The material is still there, but people do not practice all of it. But part of it is chanting mantras. So chanting mantras was also given as a way to maintain health, to improve health, and to bring back health. It's a very intricate part of the Ayurveda. So we don't hear that too much about in today's health circles about chanting mantras. In fact, there is a little bit of spillover now in some areas that people are in the health areas starting to understand that chanting mantras is also good mental health, which leads to better physical health. So you see the connection between chanting mantras. And of course, in this age, it is recommended that the Maha Mantra is the mantra for deliverance on all ages. And to use the Maha Mantra or to employ the Maha Mantra for anything material, including health, is a principle of being using the holy name in the service of the material. But automatically, if one is chanting nicely and regularly, one will grow on in all areas of life, including health, physical, mental health. Mental health and physical health is intricately related. If we're full of anxieties and disturbed, it will manifest itself on the physical level. Those who are happy, who are free from anxiety, generally have good health. Because the mind and the body are intricately connected. And just like now, we're getting a lot of information that is causing people to become fearful. When we fall into the category of fear, that will impact our mental and physical health. Physical health also, because they are directly related. The body, mind, soul, just like the word Atma. Atma means body, Atma means mind, Atma means soul. The same word means all three. It's interesting. That means in the real sense of the word, these three are intimately or connected in the principle of function. So keeping good sadhana, especially chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and other forms of sadhana, such as going to Mangal Arati, reading and hearing and discussing Srimad-Bhagavatam, and performing the activities of devotional service, is also a principle of, we say, spiritual health, but it also impacts holistic on the rest of the body. So we can see that the stronger you are in spiritual life, generally, you can keep good health. Of course, that's not the principle. But Prabhupada tells one story, how when he was a young boy, he said he was about a year and a half old. He actually remembers some of it. This is Srila Prabhupada. There was a a very strong plague that hit Calcutta, and people were dying every day by the hundreds, and they couldn't do anything. And no Kaviraj was able to find any cure for the epidemic. So then when Babaji, he decided to do Harinam Sankirtan. So he organized a group of men, and they got their instruments, and they would go throughout the whole day through the whole city, going in and out of people's houses, chanting the holy names. They did it the whole day. And after some time, the whole epidemic, the whole plague subsided, Prabhupada said. And it's understood that by that Harinam Sankirtan, it pushed back the effects. So we see even today, because people are sinful, people are sick. It's definitely related. Or if those who somehow or other become associated with sinful people, they can also become affected physically. So we have to be careful how it works, not only spiritually, but also on the health level. So keeping good health means being Krishna conscious. Because that's the health of the soul. Sometimes we say, we use the terminology that the soul is diseased. The soul cannot come in contact with matter, so there's no question of the soul being affected by matter. But due to the facility of the mind identifies with matter in relationship to its existence. And therefore, one appears to be sick. It's almost like something is covering you, but not affecting you at the same time. So in the same way, the disease of material existence, and it's also said that way, there's a beautiful part of a beautiful prayer, which is sung as a bhajan by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. He says, Enache asadi maya nasi bara lagi harinama maha mantra lao tu mi magi. That Enache asadi. Asadi means medicine. And what the medicine for maya is harinam sankirtan. That is the medicine. So the disease in this age is bhavarog. Bhavarog means material sinful activities. It's interesting, I'm in a particular country here, the Balkans, and there's some kind of folklore attached to this name bhavarog, same spelling as the Sanskrit bhavarog, and it means a very evil witch who comes around and haunts and harasses people. And so the folklore of this particular area aligns itself with the statement of material sinful life. So you see how language is connected in many ways. But along with that, we can understand that keeping good physical health also means keeping up on our Krishna consciousness. And if we keep a cup on our Krishna consciousness, then we will also have the intelligence and the clarity of mind and the peace of mind and the happiness that comes with Krishna consciousness, which will minimize any effects of illnesses. Of course, we can go into the more direct area. If we get sick, we have to take certain medicines, we might say, to cure that. But then again, those medicines, as Prabhupada says, only work if Krishna wants them to work. Prabhupada would constantly say that no doctor can cure a patient unless Krishna allows it to happen. Rake Krishna, More Ke, More Krishna, Rake Ke. If Krishna wants you to be sick, there's nothing you can do. If Krishna wants you to be well, you will, even if you get sick, you will be well in no time. So this is the principle how our spiritual life and our material well-being are somewhat connected. And here we see also in devotional service, one of the principles of devotional service is regulation. Regulation for eating, sleeping, working, and recreation. Nowadays, we find, it's a feature of Kali Yuga, people do not follow regulation. The only regulation they follow is that they have to go to work or they go to school. They're forced into a routine. But generally, if they're not forced into a routine, they have no routine. You know, I know people who live in the material world, they eat 6-7 times a day, whenever they want. Whenever the tongue says, give me something to eat, they find something and stuff it into their mouth like that. So here, it says here, because of irregular habits, people have insufficient, the duration of life is shortened. And it's really shortened in this age. And as the age continues to degrade itself at the end of Kali Yuga, and then this is prophesized in the Puranas, especially the Linga Purana, I think, and also the Bhavishya Purana, that people will live no more than 30 years of age. If one lives 30 years of age, they will be considered to be a grand old man. That's how it's mentioned in the Shastras. But so this age, there is a real effort to maintain spiritual and material health, both. Spiritual health means to apply the principles in relationship to the activities. What are the principles? The activities are hearing and chanting the glories of the Lord, associating with devotees in a mood of service and surrender, worshiping the deity form of the Lord regularly and according to the principles given, and taking Krishna prasadam at regulated times. So these are, and what are the principles that support these? Enthusiasm. Rupa Goswami mentions this in Nectar of Instructions. Enthusiasm, determination, and patience, and avoiding the association of non-devotees. Now, if we're listening to the news or the media, which is giving us the news, sometimes we do that in order to find out what's going on. We also find that we are so maybe associating with the wrong type of atmosphere. This news is usually filled with fear aspects, causing people to become fearful. I saw a little cartoon, somebody sent it to me. It's kind of a cute little cartoon. This man is sitting in front of the television and there's a man announcing on the TV that there is so much fear here and we have to find out ways to become free from fear. And so the next little caption is, the man shuts off the television. And that's how he becomes free from fear. So, it has a message. The message is that, especially nowadays, everyone is fearful of this so-called pandemic, and I use the word so-called because it's not even clear what it is. And there's a lot of evidence to show that what's going on is not really going on, but that's another thing that's quite controversial. But there are people who are not fearful about what's happening and they're living normal lives and going on. And there are others that are so fearful They're afraid to go out of their house. They're afraid to talk to other people. They're afraid to associate with other people. They're afraid to do a lot of things that they would normally do, which is, caused by this idea that they're, we are surrounded by this big monster that is coming to attack all of us at any moment. And if we don't, fully protect ourselves with various types of activities. So I would say, yes, okay, protect yourself, but protect yourself by chanting Hare Krishna, protect yourself by worshiping the deity and following the principles, protect yourself by keeping normal hygienic regimens. In other words, just like in Krishna consciousness, we also talk about what are some of the health principles. Don't stay up late. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, a great acharya, he talks about the importance of taking rest before the hour of 10 o'clock at night. He says, every hour that you sleep before midnight is worth 2 hours after midnight. And he also says that one shouldn't stay up any later than 10 o'clock in the evening. And sometimes, when I first joined the Hare Krishna movement, we were taking rest at 9. And I still do that now. I take rest about between 9 and 9:30 every night. And so going to bed early and getting up early is also a principle of health. Waking up an hour and a half before sunrise, then this is called Brahma Muhurta, which is the most conducive time for meditation, prayer, and spiritual activities. Chanting the holy names, offering prayers to the Lord in different ways, worshiping, reading holy scriptures. All these have the maximum effect in the early morning hours when the mind is somewhat free from the disturbances of the day's activities. And Krishna, in the 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, he also mentions, don't eat too much, don't eat too little, don't sleep too much, don't sleep too little, regulate your life. And this will also allow for good material and spiritual health. And so we could go into the details of health in general, and there are many details that come by way of the activities of a devotee to improve material health and spiritual. And Srila Prabhupada was very, very strong. His Holiness Prahladananda Maharaj has published one book titling it that famous statement that Prabhupada would write at the end of every one of his letters, hope this meets you in the best of health. And then Prabhupada would sign your ever well wisher, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. So Prabhupada was, and in that book, you'll find hundreds of statements by Srila Prabhupada on how to keep good health. And Prabhupada was a pharmacist before he became, fully engaged in Krishna consciousness. He had a lot of knowledge of medicine and pharmacy. And he talks a lot about the principles that make up the health regimen in Ayurveda. Doesn't give much credence to allopathic medicine, although he wasn't against it. He didn't see it as effective in living accordingly than Ayurveda, because Ayurveda is natural. It's coming from the Vedas. It's coming from Lord Vishnu himself. Danvantari is an incarnation of Vishnu coming out of the ocean of milk. So in the Vedas there, you find. So Srila Prabhupada was very, very enthusiastic that devotees learn how to balance their spiritual life with their material well-being in such a way that they can amalgamate both of these things together in one daily activity. And Prabhupada was super regulated. And regulation is the foundation for getting things done and for keeping good health. Because we are a part of nature. We are not outside of nature. Nature means the material energy and how it works. When we live according to the nature's laws, then we are actually living according to our best interest, physical and mental health like that. And the laws of nature are both gross and very, very subtle like that. So learning how to organize your health. But you know what happens? People have jobs, they have so many responsibilities, and they put all of these things foremost and sometimes fail to neglect their health. They only take care of their health after they get sick. But that's foolish. Better to maintain good health through preventative activities or supportive activities, rather than push yourself or act wrongly and then have to again, you know, kind of struggle to regain your health. So balancing these two principles of our spiritual practice, which means regulated spiritual activities accordingly, and basic hygienic principles such as cleanliness, freedom from anxiety, proper exercise, and very, very important, fresh air. Where do we get fresh air to nowadays? Years ago, I think it's still going on in some cities around the world, such as Manila in the Philippines and in Tokyo in Japan. They have these machines placed at different places around the city where you go, you put some coins in it and you put a mask over your face and you breathe oxygen. Because the air is so bad in these cities that people cannot get fresh air and therefore they're always sick. I remember when I was in Bombay a couple of years ago, the air pollution index, they have this number that they have, it's a rating where 20 is considered to be normal. And if it gets to 100, that means it's a crisis. And Bombay was 546. Not only 100 was a crisis, it was so polluted that the sun in the sky was like a mist. It was a mist over the sun, which was the pollution coming from the cities. So we live in a very dysfunctional, soul-killing, body and mental disturbing society. And therefore, to keep good health is an ongoing adventure. Therefore, we have to balance these two things, our spiritual practices and our material needs. And one should know, you know, what you need on the health level. The basic thing is take rest early, get up early, eat at a regular time, get plenty of rest, get plenty of exercise, and try to always remain positive. Even if you have to deal with problems, always remain in a positive state of consciousness. Don't let life drag you down. Remember Krishna, remember the principles of devotional life, and always realize that Krishna is the supreme controller. He is the only shelter, and he is the best friend of all living entities. If we can remember these things and live according to these principles, then we will find, you know, that Krishna consciousness becomes easy and we find it very, very happy. So we all struggle with some of these principles. See which one applies to you and work on it and try to reinstate it as something normal. But if you're good at something, increase it. Wherever you're weak, you know, work on it and strengthen it. So keeping good health means keeping good Krishna conscious activities along with maintaining the body according to the principles. And I would suggest that devotees who are struggling with health, find a nice Ayurvedic doctor, go for an analysis, and you'll find that you're able to understand clearer what is needed, because Ayurveda works on a very interesting principle. There are three dhatus or doshas in the body: vata, kapha, and pitta. And when these things, these three energies in the body, vata is the airy energy, kapha is more solid, pitta is the fiery energy. These are the three main things. When they are in balance, there is good health. And even when health is out, by rebalancing these, one can again attain good health. And of course, Ayurvedic works very much on digestion. And therefore, part of the principle of Ayurveda is food. Food is considered to be rasayana. It's one of the medicines that is given in Ayurveda. You don't find that too much in other forms of medicines, especially our modern day medicines. They don't put much, hardly any emphasis on what you eat. But Ayurveda does, because it understands that food is rasayana, it's elixir, it is medicine. So when we learn how to eat properly, balance our food intake with the proper amounts of food, along with the rest of the regimen to follow. Therefore, I recommend all the devotees, of course, it's up to you. This is a recommendation that go see an Ayurvedic doctor, someone who has some repute, who's known, and find out how you're doing. They can tell you exactly what's happening to you. They just take your pulse and they say, are you feeling like this? And you say yes, then they can immediately understand what is needed like that. Simply by taking the pulse, they can understand, diagnose any imbalance or any problems within any part of the body. And the advantage of Ayurveda is that it deals with the soul also. Whereas other forms of medicine don't take in the spiritual aspect at all, which means it's deficient. It's merely not a science at all. You can't say that allopathic medicine is science. It's not science at all, because it doesn't even consider the soul, which is the essence of the living being's existence. So there is benefits in all forms of medicine, but in a holistic sense, if we follow the principles given by Srila Prabhupada that are in the Bhagavatam, in his words and instructions, both for spiritual and material activities, we will be able to balance our life nicely in Krishna consciousness. And even if we do get sick, the remedies are quickly effective like that. That is a general statement. Of course, there is also karma. We didn't speak about karma and health, because that is also related. Just like today, the so-called pandemic, or what we call this virus, is also a lot due to the sinful activities of the living entity. So as karma builds up, there's reactions for that, and that reactions come in the form of pestilence, disease, material calamities, wars, and social, political, and economic breakdowns. These are all part of sinful activities. So people are trying to solve the problems in the world simply by where the problem appears. But that's not the way. Just like the same way how allopathic medicine works. They see the symptom of the sickness and they give you some treatment based on the symptom. But Ayurvedic, what it does, it goes to the root cause of the sickness. The symptom is just an indication, just like cancer. Cancer is an indication that your lifestyle is not right, that you have been living in the wrong way for a long time, and this, therefore, the body is no longer able to maintain, and therefore, radical cells appear, and radical cells become strong, they kill good cells, and then they become, you know, a form of disease known as cancer in different places within the body, and they travel throughout the body, killing good cells. So part of preventing cancer, which is mostly a Kali Yuga disease, we don't hear too much about it in previous ages, is simply keeping, as it says here, keeping regular habits, eating simple food. Any man can maintain his health. Overeating, over sense gratification, over dependence on another's mercy, and artificial standards of living sap the very vitality of human energy. Therefore, the duration of life is short. Artificial standards of living, that is a whole other subject. How we live is, if we're living in the present day metropolis cities, we can say that that falls into that. Natural living is the way Krishna lived. With fresh air, surrounded by animals, surrounded by people who are working together in a communal type atmosphere to support each other in all areas of life. That is more of a natural form of lifestyle, not this lifestyle we live in. We live in these boxes we call apartments, where fresh air is a shortage, noise is constant. It's like I'm trying to speak right now and outside of my window there's big loud trucks going by and making all kinds of noises. Noise pollution is another form of causing mental problems. So all of these things. So you might say, well, we just have to tolerate it. Yes, that's true. Go on. We are Krishna consciousness. But then again, there are alternatives. Okay, so I tried to cover something quite big, and I kind of expanded the range of activities. So if there's any questions, comments related to either spiritual or material well-being, we'll be happy to try to serve.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj, for a very informative session. Hare Krishna, dear devotees, if you have any questions, comment, or realization, please unmute yourself or you can type in chat window. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you for bringing to our attention the importance of maintaining our health, because this impacts our Krishna consciousness and vice versa, and how important it is to try our level best to maintain our health, even though it may be very difficult. I also like very much how you pointed out the depth and the exact nature of Ayurvedic mode of treatment. I was myself an allopathic doctor, and as I kept practicing medicine, allopathic style, I just got more and more disillusioned. I started seeing more and more problems. You give one medicine for the liver, and then the lungs get fired. You give one medicine for the kidney, then something, a pancreas gets fired. It's such an inexact science, and it has so many side effects and problems. I finally lost complete faith, and I have given it up altogether.
It's a man-made, manufactured program that comes with the principle of economic development and capitalism.
Right.
Ayurvedic is coming from, you know, the Vedas. It's given by Lord Vishnu himself. The problem with Ayurveda, or not problem, the reason why people don't want to go to Ayurveda is because the treatments are long-term. People want a quick fix. And so they hand you a pill or a bottle of medicine and say, here, you're on your way. But Ayurveda requires sometimes a lifestyle change in order to get cured, along with a diet change and proper, and also, you know, keeping good consciousness. It requires a little bit more of an effort, but if you can maintain yourself through that principle, learning how to balance your life according to Ayurvedic standards of living, and you won't get sick.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Guru Maharaj. Thank you for reminding us that health is the real wealth.
Yeah, spiritual health and material health. We Prabhupada put a lot of emphasis on our material health because it impacts our spiritual health. But at the same time, he wanted devotees to stay healthy because, you know, they say if you lose your money, you lose nothing. If you lose your health, you lose something.
Yes. Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
If you lose Krishna, you lose everything.
So, Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. I have one question. Guru Maharaj, you mentioned about these four principles and cleanliness.
Mercifulness, cleanliness, austerity, and truthfulness.
Yeah. And you mentioned like in Kali Yuga, it's like we are just hinging on the age of truthfulness. Why we like feel like mercy is like missing? Is just because of like we are not treating living entity properly? Is that the reason?
Or? Mercy means there's wanton killing. We're killing babies in the womb. We're killing cows. We kill each other all the time. Everybody's, you know, you'll see there's so much killing going on. They say that this coronavirus was caused by bats, by capturing bats, cooking bats. Every one of the epidemics is connected with some kind of animal, exploitation of animals, such as, one with the monkeys is, forgot the one connected with monkeys. There's the you know, flu. Yeah, HIV is connected with monkeys, and swine flu, Ebola, all of them are connected with animal exploitations. Yeah, because we're killing cows, hundreds and thousands of cows are sent to the slaughterhouse every day around the world. People think this, you know, you can just kill animals and nothing will happen. They don't understand the law of karma. That's very, very heavy karma. And as it builds up, it comes out in the form of war and pestilence. It's even noted by some philanthropists. George Bernard Shaw even wrote about that, that the killing of animals leads to wars. It's what material nature does. If a nation engages in killing as a means for livelihood, then what happens is that same nation will find itself in conflict. Yeah. So yeah, just like this, you know, I mean, of course, there are different opinions, but the virus that's going around, if you read the Srimad-Bhagavatam, you see that these things come by way of sinful activities. Any form of epidemic, pestilence, is all due to the collective karma of sinful activities. Mother Earth is a living being, and she is to be respected, and she is to be cared for and not exploited. So today's society, what do? We simply rape the earth for more and more material resources. We kill each other in the name of economic development. We kill animals in the name of sense gratification. We kill children in the wombs before they're even born in the name of wanting to take on the responsibility of raising children. So you know, these are very, very heavy sinful activities. They're not small ones. And when it can become so strong, you have worldwide calamity. These are the laws of nature. These are the laws of God. This is in the Bhagavatam. Now, when King Venu was the king, he stopped all Vedic sacrifices. He dispensed with the Brahmanas. He didn't want to follow any of the Vedic principles. And then, of course, the Brahmins came back at him and chanted mantras and ultimately killed him by chanting mantras. And from that, from his body, later on, a great soul was born, and that was King Prithu. But when Prithu came, the earth was withholding all of her bounty. Just like to now today, they say there's a shortage of resources in the world. And that is simply a euphemism. It's not a shortage of resources in the world. Prabhupada said, if people live according to the laws of God, the earth can produce 10 times as much as it's producing now. 10 times as much as the population. There's no such thing as overpopulation. Overpopulation is simply a creation of the demoniac principle done by one particular economist. His name was Thomas Malthus. Prabhupada talks about him. He says there's too many people in the world, and therefore, in order to keep the population at a certain level, there must be regular wars and pestilence. And this will flatten the curve of the population, so that way the earth can provide the needs of those that are left. But this is complete fantasy. It has nothing to do with reality. Yes, the earth will withhold when people are sinful. But when people are pious, not even religious, not even spiritual, but at least pious, then the earth will produce. And you'll have so much, just like Prabhupada said. He said, I can see that sometimes in India during the mango season, there is so much mangoes that people can't even stockpile enough of them. They have so many mangoes, they're using mangoes for everything, and mangoes are big and juicy and plentiful. But then he said, but then another season of mango season will come, and there's hardly any mangoes. And some, even the ones that come, are of very low quality. So why is that? One season, everything is so plentiful and so profuse. And then another season, nothing. Why? It's because of the sinful barometer of the population. The earth withholds and gives accordingly. The earth is mother. That's why we say Mother Earth. She is the provider. We live to respect our mother, to honor our mother. We honor our mother by honoring our father, by following his instructions. That is called Krishna consciousness. But even if people don't worship the Lord in devotion, at least if they follow the principles of piety, which are the principles of the mode of goodness, which is still within the realm of material, the earth will provide. But now people are so sinful, and it's not their fault. It's mostly because of the leadership in the world that is propagating sinful activity in the name of economic development. So it's good business to kill cows. It's good business to kill babies. It's good business to propagate, you know, all kinds of false kinds of medical solutions in the name of getting people cured. You know, they'll say anything, they'll sell anything just to make money. Out of all the qualities that destroy the character of the human being, we have the listing: lust, anger, greed, illusion, pride, and envy. The two worst ones are greed and envy. And greed just destroys all the qualities of the living being. Greed is the most insidious and self-destructive quality. And we have now greed for everything. Becoming greedy for sex, for food, for money, for you name it, greed, greed, greed. And it's being pushed as a way of life. Have more, get more, do more. And then you wonder why that the psychological health of the world is very much challenged. That's why it says the World Health Organization out of Washington, D.C. said that the number one sickness in the world is mental health. Number one. And it's only increasing. So devotees can be free from that. They just stay strict in their Krishna consciousness and follow very carefully a principle of normal health program. I mean, there's much we can say on health. Health is a huge subject. It's a diverse subject. It's also controversial in how we see it also. But if you go back to the essence, it's coming from the Vedas. The Vedas are the sources of everything, and they're also source of the principle of spiritual and material well-being, all coming from the Vedas. Vedas don't deal just with the spiritual topics, they deal with other things related to human needs and human interests.
Thank you, Guru.
Why do we put so much faith in secular society and in the scientists when Srila Prabhupada has spoken so strongly against? You listen to Srila Prabhupada's lectures, he not only he categorizes them, but he shows how faulty they are in giving information to society in general. That's why, if you listen to the news, if you read the newspapers, if you go along with the common stream news, you'll become completely confused. Therefore, we should get all our information from Srila Prabhupada. Everything is there in Prabhupada's books and his lectures and in the process of devotional service. It's a complete lifestyle that includes all aspects of life. And if there's something material needed, we can find it in relationship to Krishna consciousness. Social, political, economic, medical, philanthropical, military, it's all there in the Vedas, Vedic knowledge. But we've thrown that all away, seeing it as primitive, not practical, and we just take this modern day, and therefore we have so many problems.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Guru Maharaj. It's really, really helpful. Thank you. Hare Krishna. I see one comment from Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu. He is saying, Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, your point about health and Ayurveda is very true. My mother was an allopathy doctor, but she always recommended Ayurvedic and homeopathy for everyone. Even for her children, to us, she never used allopathy medicines. Hare Krishna.
She was an allopathic doctor who recommended Ayurveda.
Yes, and homeopathy.
I guess she was just trying to make a living. Yeah. When I got sick, they say I had the COVID virus, I'm not sure, but I contacted my Ayurvedic doctor. He said, Danvantari Gulika. Find it, take it. And I found it, I took it. And along with other things, it was good.
Guru Maharaj, please may I ask one more question? It is about this prevalent belief that cancer cannot be treated other than, you know, radical chemotherapy and surgery and things like that. But can Ayurveda treat cancers also?
In Gujarat, there's one of the most popular Ayurvedic, well, it's a holistic program for curing cancer. They have when the last information I connected with, which was about 2 years ago, they have 4,000 successful treatments of cancer victims. It's somewhere in Gujarat. I have the information somewhere in my computer. And there are many, many places in India that deal with. And cancer is like anything else. It's just a disease of, it's a lifestyle disease, basically. We don't live properly, then the body doesn't function properly, and then radical cells develop. Radical cells become strong enough, they start killing good cells, and then that spreads, and that is what is cancer, basically. That's leukemia is like that also. Cancer is like that. I spoke to one Ayurvedic doctor. He said, cancer is simply a sign. It's actually a helpful sign that showing that you're living wrongly. Your whole lifestyle needs to be readjusted. And that's what Prabhupada's saying in this verse we did, that it's mostly due to irregular habits, wrong lifestyle, that we have all these health problems.
Yes, Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much.
Guru Maharaj, there is one question on Facebook from Kelly Brindavan Devi Mataji. She is asking, Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you very much. You said that prevention is more important. Why I can't be more regulated? is that I have some material attachments. Is that correct? Is that right? If so, do you have any advice on how to be more regulated?
Well, I gave a little. Start off with the basics.
Yeah.
Regulate your sleeping the best you can. Regulate your eating. Eat only Krishna prasadam. Get good exercise. Follow, you know, a diet that is, find out what is the best diet for you. Just like I'm going to an Ayurvedic doctor right now. I've been going for about 6 weeks. I have an appointment tomorrow. And he put me on, you know, he gave me a whole, like 6 pages of listings of foods. And he had me sit down and check yes and no next to each item. What foods I should eat and what foods I should not eat. So, you know, and then as I was getting better, you know, he allowed more foods to be taken. So first find out where you are imbalanced in your health. See what food is really like medicine, and see what you can adjust. But I would suggest, don't try to be your own doctor. That's not very good. Even Ayurveda doesn't recommend you become your own doctor. Or don't try to become the doctor for your own family. Get a physician who is qualified. And today you can find, you know, good Ayurvedic doctors practically in many places. We have two here in Ljubljana, and one we're going to regularly, and he's helping all the devotees here. So yeah, see what you need to do. I can't be your doctor over the computer, but I can tell you that try to rebalance your life and find out what you need in order to rebalance your life. Because it's all based on balance. When all the airs in the body are balanced, when lifestyles are somewhat balanced, then there is optimum health generally. But the desire for sense gratification could cause us to do things that are detrimental for our health, for our spiritual health, for our material health also. Just because you like a particular food doesn't mean it's the best food for you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. We are already 17 minutes over, but I see Sudha Mataji has raised the hand. Can we take as a last question?
Sudha, yeah.
Hare Krishna, Dhanut Pranam Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Maharaj. So Maharaj, thank you for the wonderful information. I have some personal experience with all this sickness and all that. So I just have a question, Guru Maharaj. So disease is called...
We lost you.
Mm-hmm. Due to your past karma. Just trying to understand... So Mataji,
we lost you in between. So can you please repeat, Mataji?
Oh, sorry, Prabhuji. I think my internet is not very good. I feel okay. Is it okay, Prabhuji? Can you hear
me? Yes, I can hear you now, Mataji. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji. Please. Continue, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Okay. Sorry, Maharaj. I think I have some internet problem. So Guru Maharaj, I'm just trying to understand, like, diseases, are they caused due to your past karma or due to, like, irregular lifestyle? Sometimes, like, even though, like, you have, like, a very regular lifestyle, you see, like, people, like, falling sick.
There's many reasons. Lifestyle is the main thing that will help to balance our health, but there are effects from karmic activities too. That's also there. But when you take the Krishna consciousness, your past karma is also gradually changed. As you chant, as you practice devotional service and take part in the activities, the effects of previous karma are eradicated, both good and bad karma. That is mentioned in the Nectar of Devotion.
Okay.
So yeah, we may have some effects from the past, but stay in Krishna consciousness and do the needful. But don't worry. If we happiness is a sign of good health. If you're happy, you're healthy.
Yes, Guru Maharaj. Also Guru Maharaj, what I personally notice, like, even though, like, I try to, like, you know, do chanting and try as much as possible to regularize my things, because, like, outside food industry is so corrupted. I mean, we do cook and offer, we see those effects, those imbalances by that food, and due to that also not able to do, like, you know, justify, like, you know, my sleeping habits, like, you know, how can we actually help with those things, Guru Maharaj? Like,
I would say get advice on how to do it. Each situation is different. Practical advice, you may understand a little by your own observation what you need to do, but get practical advice from people who are qualified to give advice. For me to say anything specific would be just pretentious, because I don't really know the situation. When my presentation was based on general principles. Specifically, it really takes some advice from either a physician or someone who was qualified in that area.
Okay, Guru Maharaj. Because if we go to, like, a grocery store, everything is like, nothing is like,
fresh.
You know, fresh, like, even vegetables, we are eating, like, most of the time, like, you know, they store in the refrigerator and they try to bring it, and we are forced to buy that, and we see some effects from those things.
In Kali Yuga, the air is polluted, the food is polluted, mm-hmm. People's minds are polluted, people's lifestyles are polluted. Prabhupada's direction for us was to set up the farm communities and develop a lifestyle which is both conducive to good health and to the practice of Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada saw that the cities that we live in will soon be finished. He said that these cities won't last. There will be chaos in the cities. This whole civilization will collapse, he said. He said it so many times in different lectures. He said, therefore, we must establish our farm communities in order for our society to go on in a very viable way. He said, we can still stay in the cities for preaching, but for living, we should live in close to nature the way Krishna lived. That means growing your own food, keeping cows. These are, so it's not like it's impractical. It's being done in many places. But if we live in the cities, this is what you get. If you can start your own garden and try to grow your own food, that may help to some degree. Just like I get water. I live in a city, but I have some devotees who get water from a natural stream for me. I don't take any tap water or bottled water from any stores. I drink only ahimsa milk coming from cows. There's some devotees who have farms and I get milk from there. I get cheese also from our cows like that. So I won't take milk, cheese, and water from mainstream. I try to get it. The vegetables I have no control over. And therefore we get low quality vegetables and we just do the best we can. It's all from to Krishna. What can we do? But ideally is what Prabhupada wanted us to do, is to establish these farm communities. So soon I will I presented 4 lectures this year and 4 lectures last year on natural living. I'm about to publish those 4 lectures I did last year in the form of a small book, which will come out and it'll answer many of the questions along with the vision that Srila Prabhupada had for our society. So yeah, we live a compromised lifestyle. There's no question about it. So how compromised do you want to be before we become too much affected by it?
So Maharaj, Guru is offering and we are offering and we are doing everything. So it will minimize the effects. We are offering and we are eating the prasadam. So when we offer, will it minimize the effects? We are offering and we are eating the prasadam. So when we offer, it will minimize the effects, right, Guru Maharaj?
Well, it becomes prasadam. Uh-huh. Yeah. It becomes spiritual food. Mm-hmm. But still, we should choose our food in the best quality.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and then that's another topic. Food is a whole other topic in itself. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get into that because it opens up another political question, economic question. But generally, Prabhupada said, get these farms. And take some time. This is the summer. You can travel a little bit now. Go to one of our farms. You can go to Gita Nagari. That's close. You can go to, let's see where else we have farms. New Vrindavan is not so much of a farm community. Gita Nagari is. And just see how the devotees are living. You can talk to my disciple Kishori, Prem Kishori. She's a doctor and she also spends time at Gita Nagari. Okay. So we might not be able to live there right away, but experiment with the idea and see. Because, Prabhupada is saying that these cities are not going to last. If we depend on cities for our livelihood, we might find ourselves, struggling to maintain after some time. Anytime, they put you in this lockdown, which is really unnatural. You can't go out, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this. It's unhealthy. That's not the way we're supposed to live. It's another form of imprisonment. Mm-hmm. Has nothing to do with health either. I'm in one of the healthiest countries in the world. This is Slovenia here. People are very healthy here generally. It's a very outdoorsy country. And people are practically every weekend, at least when the weather is good, people are in the mountains. And during the day, they're out riding bicycles, they're in the parks, they do exercise. It's a very active country. People don't like to stay indoors here. They're just very, you know, active on the outside like that. Generally, it's quite a healthy country, in comparatively speaking to other countries like that. If you stay in the house all the time, not only will you get sick, but you'll get mentally disturbed also.
Yes, yes, Maharaj.
Get out. Yes. Go swimming, yes. Or
yes,
go exercising. Go see some friends, spend some time. Don't stay in the house.
yes, Guru Maharaj. Definitely. Yeah. Yes, Guru Maharaj. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Definitely. We will look forward. I mean, we can try out and we can explore and we'll see how it goes. Yeah. Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much, Guru Maharaj. Hare Krishna. Dhanut Pranam.
So Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, we are 30 minutes over, but there is one question from Shridevi Mataji on chat. She is asking, our dear godbrother Janki Nath is suffering from cancer. Has he received good treatment so far?
Well, last night I was with Janki Nath and his caretakers, and his Ayurvedic doctor is having some progress. So the last report was he has gotten better, but it's not really an indication of anything substantial. All it means is that there is some good signs coming up. If it continues in that way, then that's success. But right now he's still quite debilitated, but slightly better than he was last week. Anyway, continue your prayers. That's the most important. Prayers of devotees will make a difference.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. There is no any other question on chat window, Maharaj. If it's okay with you, we can close the session today.
Yeah, let's close it and we'll see you all tomorrow.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Anant Koti Vaishnav Brind ki jai.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj.